Well, good morning today. Today is Monday, January 17th, and we're still in the year 2011, so that's a good thing about it. If you haven't seen a blog yet this year, Happy New Year, and I pray that you would have the greatest 2011 of your life, the greatest year of your life. For the last 2 weeks, we've been in the book of Romans. We've spent the last 10 video blogs discussing the first 17 verses of Romans chapter 1. We're going to do verse 18, 19, and 20 today. And in all honesty, it's a difficult passage of scripture for me to kind of break down, for lack of a better term. It's not a scripture that I've heard preached on a lot. When you take Romans 1 to 17, oh my gosh, everybody preaches, you know, the gospel is the power of God to save. And, you know, about impartation, the glory of God, the resurrection power of the Spirit of holiness, and all these things that we've talked about the last 2 weeks. And if you haven't watched those, I encourage you, you can go back, and they're all up on our YouTube account. You can watch them all. And it's, you know, it's pretty good stuff, I think, in my own humble opinion, right? But verse 18, this is the Word of God. I'm not, you know, I didn't write it. It's the Apostle Paul wrote it. And it is canonized. It is holy scripture, and it is the word of God. Verse 18 says this: "But God shows His anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness." That's the New Living Translation. The New King James Version says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." And that word suppress, it literally means, I'm just looking up here in verse 18, that word suppress means to hold down. It says men that hold down the truth. It's kind of like if you have a child, and I was thinking about this. And if somebody had food for your hungry, starving child, and they were holding it back. They had a surplus of food, they had an abundance of it, and they said, "You know what, we're gonna let your child starve to death." You'd be pretty angry, wouldn't you? You'd be pretty hostile. You would do whatever it took to get your child that food so that he could survive. Well, truth and the things of God and reality and just the love of God and the message of the gospel, the message of Jesus Christ, is life to our spirit, is life to our soul. So God, in our Heavenly Father, who God is love, but He gets angry when people know the truth and they hold it back from others. They know the truth, they're like, "You know what, I believe this, but I'm just going to do my own thing and forget about that. And you know what? I'm going to mess up. I'm going to take as many people as I can with me." That, to me, is exactly what this scripture is. I talk about wicked people who, by their wickedness and by their unrighteousness, suppress the truth. And God gets angry at that. The next verse says in verse 19, "They know the truth about God because He has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see His invisible qualities, His eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God." And I think that is, Paul's talking, I don't know if he's necessarily talking about everybody, but he's talking about a lot of people. You know, some people that perhaps have been abused as children, or different traumatic things have happened to their life. Sometimes it's like, well, where was God? And they've got a lot of sorting through to do and different things. And some people that just, you know, they grew up in the truth and they've just rebelled against it. God's saying, "Man, you don't have an excuse. Here I am. I'm the creator of the world. And you do not have an excuse for not knowing me." Tomorrow I'm going to share an essay that I wrote just about the reality of God and what it can be. Because I've wrestled these things out, believe you me. I've taken scriptures like these and just the truth of people rejecting God. So, "God, what's up with that? How can people reject you? I don't get it." And the Lord has the Lord. I believe He's given me some deeper revelation on that. Some of it I'll share either tomorrow or this week as we kind of delve into these topics. But I want just to communicate this today, that I believe that although God is love, He's passionate. You got to understand, the opposite of love isn't hate. The opposite of love, in my view, is selfishness. So people can either love and serve others, or we can be selfish and just serve ourselves. And God's saying, man, if you do that, you're going to self-destruct. Because if your life is all about you, and all about just serving your needs, eventually you're just going to run out, man. And it's going to be done for you. So we'll talk about these subjects in a little bit deeper matter this week. And this is some challenging kind of scripture and verses to get through. Feel free to comment if you feel like you have some insight. And this video blog isn't necessarily to have all the answers, but just to kind of discuss and bring some of these things to light. But the other point my camera guy made, let's just say this lastly, is that all the wrath of God, all the anger of God was taken out on the cross on Jesus Christ. You don't have to be under the wrath of God. The Bible says that God's throne is the foundation of His throne is on righteousness and justice. And so God is just. You know, He's a just judge. He will punish sin. Now, the gospel, the good news, is part of, a big part of it. And the beginning part of it is that you don't have to suffer the consequences of your sin. That when you come to Jesus, you can actually, through His atoning blood, you can repent and receive His forgiveness. And you can go scot-free from your sin and from the consequences of it as you repent. Sometimes the consequences, you know, they take a little bit to get out and to kind of work through, but you can be forgiven and you can be set free from those things. But you don't have to. You can choose to say, you know what, I'm just going to live my life and forget Jesus, forget Christ, forget His cross, forget His blood. And I'm just going to, I'll face that thing. And there's some people who I've talked to, they say, oh, I know I'm going to hell. I know I'm going to hell. And it breaks my heart when people say that to me, but I'll go to hell. And I'm like, man, I don't get it. I just don't get it. If that's where you know you're going. It's a hard reality, because hell is a real place. It's an eternal place. And so is the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. So God bless you today. Difficult things, or sometimes challenging things, rather, to think about, but we'll delve into a little bit more. A little bit longer blog on this Monday. We'll shorten it up next week's, or later on in the weekend. So God bless you today, and we'll see you tomorrow.